this very iconic building in Liverpool, and when you get off the train at the city's station, Lime Street, and look straight ahead, you'll see it. It's a neoclassical design. Anyway, so this is about the Great Hall from the balcony in St. George's Hall. To celebrate the greatness of Liverpool through the magnificence of its design and decoration. In this, it succeeds triumphantly through a display of virtuoso and surpassing extravagance, heightening the impression created by the grandeur of the neoclassical exterior. The neoclassical style emphasizes Liverpool's claim of the Roman Emperor, Caracalla in Rome. is elaborately and richly embellished with a symbolic pattern of coat of arms and decorative designs. St. George of England and the dragon in each of the four corners is supported on both sides by Liverpool's coat of arms. These are linked with those of Lancastria, Lancashire, and surround the royal coat of arms in the centre as if protecting the monarchy. The royal coat of arms also marks the centre of the design on the floor, as can be appreciated when it is open to view. The Liverpool coat of arms on the vault of the ceiling depict Neptune on one side of a live bird and Mercury on the other. The vertical panels that embrace the coats of arms depict the staff of Mercury, the caduceus entwined by snakes on one side, and rods bound together, Roman symbols of authority. So, here, yet again, on the ceiling, the corporation coat of arms, on the ceiling of the Great Hall, with symbols of Mercury left and fasces right. Just above are a series of panels with alternating designs, one of Neptune's trident in the centre, flanked by Nereids playing the lyre, the other of Mercury's head in the centre with seahorses blowing conches like tridents. Ship. Only losing his official position, he prevailed on a friend to claim that Virginia had been his slave. She had been stolen from his house where she was born and palmed off on Virginia's as his daughter. As she made her way to school, the unsuspecting and terrified girl was arrested in one of the tents in the forum. Friends immediately set out to warn her father, who only managed to return to Rome in time because Appius's orders for him to remain in post arrived too late. The matter went to trial, with Appius himself presiding. He pronounced that his friend's claim on Virginia was lawful. She should become his slave. Her father, seeing that his daughter was bound to fall into Appius's clutches, killed her with his words. Killed her with the words, "Appius, with this blood I condemn you and your head." Her life to destruction. Her death was not in vain. The people resisted the arrest of Virginius. Appius was forced into exile, and the rights of the people restored. A story and a half. The door at the back of the entrance hall is a fine example of the Erechtheian type. Is about to devour its victim. Perseus killed the monster. express her love, and she can only repeat the last words spoken to her. This was the punishment Juno had given her for telling stories to distract her while Jupiter enjoyed himself with his favourite nymphs. The scene is beautiful but full of foreboding, and the flowers at Narcissus's feet carry an ominous message. Echo will pass away remains. Narcissus too will waste away, as his love will never be returned, and when he dies, the flower that bears his name will spring up in memory of him, tinged with the red of his blood. Central Library. This is the Picton Library, which is a